Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Secret Life of Houdini, The Making of America's First Superhero by William Kalush and Larry Sloman. Read by Adam Grupper.
The first shovel load missed his torso and struck his neck, sending soil flying up his nostrils and into his mouth. He started choking and coughing. "Sorry, boss," Colin said, looking down into the hole. "I guess the wind took it." "Stay calm. Conserve energy. Keep the heart rate down." Collins and Vickery continued to fill the cavity with moist Santa Ana soil. They had been at this since a little past dawn, and their arms were beginning to ache with fatigue. They could only imagine how he must feel. Subconsciously, they moved into a rhythm, one scraping his shovel into the mounds of dirt piled high around them, the other sending his payload straight down into the dank hole. Vickery thought of how his friends would react when he told them of Harry's latest stunt. Of course, that would have to wait until after it was performed. He'd never forget that oath of secrecy that he'd sworn, and how seriously Harry seemed to take it. "Am I pushing myself too hard? I'm 41, but I look 50. I'm so gray." Vickery began to admit to himself his concern. He had expected his boss to have no problem with the 1 and even the 2-foot plantings, as he called them, and he didn't. But the 4 and 5-foot escapes seemed to really have taken something out of him. What if he'd hurt himself now, like the time he did in Buffalo? Ever since Harry had burst that blood vessel getting out of those chains, he'd had to sleep with a pillow under his left kidney. He was in such intense, chronic pain. Vickery never forgave himself for allowing those bastards to pull the chains so tight. "It's so much hotter down here. How can a few feet make such a difference? I'm starting to feel faint. Stay calm." By now, the dirt had almost completely covered Houdini's body. The shackles that held his ankles together were completely buried, and the content of 2 or 3 more shovelfuls would obscure the last traces of those handcuffs. He knew that his head would be covered next, so he could brace for the assault of the heavy soil and not have to eat some again. "This would be so much easier if I did it in a coffin. We could gimmick a plank. I'd be able to disperse so much more soil using that instead of my bare hands. I'd be out in half the time." As soon as he was completely covered by the soil, he began to go to work. Even though his assistants were still filling in the last of the grave, he swiftly slipped out of the cuffs, crouched into a fetal position, and began working on the leg irons. Within seconds, he was free of them, too. Now all he had to do was work his way up against the loose earth, slowly, methodically, timing it so that he would be just below the ground when they had finished filling in the hole. Then he'd claw through the loose topsoil and literally escape the grave. But he didn't figure on panicking. It wasn't the eerie darkness or the complete silence down there that horrified him. He had grown accustomed to that. It was the sudden realization that he was 6 feet underground, the legal requirement for corpses, that sent a chill up his spine. "What if I die here? What a field day they'd have in the papers. Houdini digs his own grave. I'd be a laughingstock." He gasped involuntarily. Now he began to claw and knee the soil without any concern that he'd get out before they had finished filling in the hole. But that momentary scare, the irretrievable mistake of all daredevils, had wasted a fraction of his breath when every last fraction was needed to get out of this hole. Up above, Collins and Vickery and the others in the party had no idea of the drama that was unfolding 4 feet below them.
"No, this can't be! Out! Get out! Get out!"
All of a sudden, the weight of the earth above him felt like 1,000 tons. His body stiffened. And for one quick second, he smelled the acrid odor of death. And then, for the first time in his life, he screamed for help. But that just made it worse. There was no way they could hear him. And now he was squandering what little air and energy he had left. He started pawing at the dirt above him like a wild animal, scratching his hands and arms on the coarse soil. He had long abandoned his slow, steady, rhythmic breathing, and now he was operating on pure instinct, swallowing and inhaling as much soil as air, in one last desperate attempt to escape. On the ground, Collins had put down his shovel and took out his watch. When it passed the 10-minute mark, he looked at Vickery with concern. "If he's not up in 30 seconds, we better go get him," he said. Vickery nodded grimly. The clock slowly ticked off the requisite seconds. And then, just as Collins and Vickery grabbed their shovels and started to frantically dig, the earth suddenly burst open and expelled a bloody, battered, and filthy Houdini, grateful for that measure of fresh, cool California air.
"Come, come, push, push, it's almost over."
Anne Fleischman was urging Cecilia Weiss on, alternately wiping her brow and giving her some ice chips to suck on. The small room had been emptied, the three young boys sent out to play. Only a few neighbors were there as Anne expertly cradled the baby's head and turned it slightly to allow the shoulders to emerge. She gently grabbed the baby's chest as the rest of the bloody body was expelled from the womb.
"Another boy,"
Anne said, expertly clipping the umbilical cord and swathing the baby in a clean sheet. Then she presented little Eric to his mother, who immediately nestled him to her bosom, where her heartbeat seemed to have a soothing effect on the newborn. It was a sanctuary to which he would often return, that steady heartbeat and her warm caress, a place where the woes of the world could be forgotten. Of course, a newborn meant another mouth to feed and another warm body to share this typically small room and kitchen flat in the predominantly Jewish section of Pest, part of the newly consolidated town of Budapest, Hungary. That made four sons now for Mayor Samuel Weiss, who had recently graduated law school. In 1876, when Eric was 2 years old, his father set off for a new life in America. Cecilia and the five children followed on June 19, 1878. Cecilia's steerage ticket cost $30, and that afforded her and her sons the privilege of being packed like cattle below the deck in a fetid, poorly lit and ventilated dormitory that held 620 people. Luckily, on this particular voyage, the ship was less than half full, which allowed Cecilia to spread out over several cots instead of just one. They arrived in New York on July 3rd and were processed at the Castle Garden Immigration Building, where each of them received a new name. Since Cecilia didn't speak English, her responses to the officials were in German, so their names became English variants of German names. Armin became Herman. 8-year-old Natan just had an H added. 6-year-old Gottfried Vilmos was dubbed William, and the baby, Ferenc Dezo, was officially named Theo, later to be nicknamed Dash. Cecilia was reunited in New York with her mother and two sisters, who had emigrated earlier. But by September, the entire Weiss family was together again in Appleton, Wisconsin. Appleton was a stark contrast to the cramped tenement buildings of New York. Only in existence for 25 years, it still had the feel in some ways of a frontier outpost. For the first 3 years of the Weiss's residence there, livestock were allowed to run free in the streets of the city. On the other hand, with a long-established college, Lawrence University, a soon-to-open opera house, and as a regular stop on the lecture circuit, there was a sense of culture that set Appleton apart from its sleepy, farm-based, small Midwestern town counterparts. And for Mayor Samuel Weiss, it had one advantage. He was a friend of one of the town's most prominent businessmen. David Hamill was a clear example of the assimilationist spirit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.